Star 101 students. This is the introduction to public administration. Today we are on knowledge area 4, which is about public administration in Tanzania. My name is Ahmed Musa, your course instructor from the Open University of Tanzania. This lecture intends to give students a historical overview of public administration in Tanzania. Doing so, historical approach will be employed to describe how past institutions and events shaped the current institutions. Our overview begins from the pre-colonial period all the way through colonial period to post-independence era, particularly during the era of structural adjustment and later to the era of governance reforms. Now let us begin with public administration in Tanzania before colonialism. The roots of public administration in Tanzania can be traced early during pre-colonial societies. The pre-colonial societies in Tanzania managed to organize themselves into centralized forms, such as the clanship and so on and so forth, where leaders and leadership began to emerge in order to administer or supervise the affairs of their societies. There were nominal traditional arrangements in pre-colonial societies in Tanzania where leadership and administrative practices were exercised. These include the agency organization for Maasai people, internship organization for the societies like Gogo, Yao, Ehe. Also, there were clanship of the like in Haya, Chaga, the societies, and the like. For example, of traditional leaders who were prevalent during pre-colonial times were Nyamwezi internship under Chief Milambo, the Hehe under Chief Mkwawa, the Yao under Machemba, the Mboni under Chavuma, Sambasa Kingweli, the Chief Rumanika of Karagwe, and others, a series of small kingdoms that records the existence of traditional leadership and administration were prevalent during this time. In these societies, there were known systems of succession and administration arrangements. By whatever name a leader was known, be it a chief or a king or a spokesperson, criteria for leadership succession were established. Normally, in some societies, the leadership succession were hereditary. There could be a son or a daughter of one designated by the chief or king according to the criteria delineated by the culture of that society or a tribe. In some societies, succession were based on qualities of the person, such as rainmaker, a battle leader, an arbitrator, and so on and so forth. Also, during this time in these societies, hierarchical societies, there were no bureaucracies for tax collection, for security purposes, etc. Division of labor were delineated. Duties, functions, and responsibilities were specified to segment members of the society. You can recall the agency societies how duties were divided. Generally, these institutions or traditional organizations were later employed by colonialists in forming and administering their colonies. Another period where we can review as the public administration in Tanzania, it is during colonial period. During late 19th century, Once now the traditional administrative system in Tanganyika were ended by colonial rule. Tanganyika by then was put under German direct rule, and later, after the First World War, it was put under British administration, which is direct rule. Soon after colonial invasion, the administrative system were redesigned to meet the interests of colonial masters. Bureaucracies were shaped to reflect the interests of colonial rule. They had to be loyal and ready to serve the colonial government at whatever cost and in whatever circumstances. The traditional system of leadership, succession, and administrative arrangement were largely maintained at local levels. However, the colonial administration had interfered and shaped local administration in a manner that consolidated their system of rule. One of those colonial administrative systems is the British administration. You can see here the British administration structure, which was comprised of the Queen, Governor, the Provincial or Regional Commissioner, the District Commissioners, and the local administration of the names like the Wallis and the Jumbes. The Queen was the head of the state, was the head of the state, but the governor below the Queen was a representative of the Queen's interests in the colonies. So those names in the bracket were some of the governors who ever ruled the Tanganyika colony. Below the governor, there was a provincial or regional commissioner. These ones who were representative of governor in provinces, provinces. Below the regional or provincial commissioners, that was district commissioners. These were representatives of governor in district levels. And here, it is where the local administration was, where the traditional local rulers once prevailed, were put here at the local levels. Another era, it is public administration post-colonial times. Public administration in Tanzania in post-colonial times. Here we have several periods where we can recall some events that define the public administration in Tanzania. Here we have the period one, which is from 1961 to 1980s, where at this time we say that early 1961, Tanganyika got independence. Meanwhile, in Zanzibar, the Sultan was overthrown in a revolution in January 1964. In April 1964, Tanganyika and Zanzibar united to form the United Republic of Tanzania. At this time, say that Tanzania did inherit the British Westminster model of government, where there is a head of state who is the president, and head of government function in the parliament, that is prime minister. By large, features of British colonial administration structure is prevalent in Tanzania administrative system. Soon after independence, the government identified poverty, disease, and ignorance as the major national enemies. In an effort to eradicate these enemies, the government pursued social, political, and economic policies that redefine the roles and function of the state. As an effort to bring unity among people toward the policies of development, in 1965, the constitution was changed to establish one-party system. And in February 1964, the government adopted the Arusha Declaration. The declaration furthered the socialist development economic ideas that led to extensive government involvement in all social spheres, in addition to centralized economic planning and control and delivery of social service. Through Arusha Declaration, egalitarian ideas were implemented, such as nationalization of the major sectors of foreign capital in the country as a means to establish a state-owned economy. Under the policy of Ujamaa Vijijini, means rural socialism, stressing the need for a type of development that was rural-based and derived its dynamism from internal sources and communal production by peasants as an expression of self-rule reliance. Arusha Declaration led to adoption of leadership code, as it was believed without the ethical leaders, advocated policies would not be attained. There were critiques thrown to this political era over the legislative time, say that critiques of this administration highlights the villagerization policy was a failure. The critiques highlighted that the villagerization was a failure. People were moving from their areas of death, and some people were not poor, but they were forced to form part of collectives. This eventually led to the failure of these new villages. Others highlight that there was this fight between domestic savings and investment, and funding development spending with too little regard for the current resources basically to sustain the expanded activities. This was attributed by weak tax base and any growth from donors who were against the socialist policies. Generally, shortfalls of Ujamaa practices, altogether with fall of prices of cash crops and oil prices in the 1970s, combined with natural disasters and the war with Uganda in the late 1970s, crippled the Tanzania's economy toward the economic crisis of the late 1970s. Then we have a video which witnessed the changes from state-controlled economy to liberalism type of economic policies, which was during the 1980s. In the 1980s, the failure of Tanzania socialism was obvious. By 1985, the government was essentially bankrupt and had little choice but to comply with the World Bank and the IMF, policies. In order to cut the growing socio-economic crisis, Tanzania, like other countries in sub-Saharan Africa, entered into formal negotiation with IMF and the World Bank for the implementation of structural adjustment policies, that is, popularly known as SAPS, SAP, and the economic recovery programs, the ERPs. The results of which was reintroduction of market-based economic system in 1966. We can see the state was shifting from the control of economic policies toward the market-based economic system. The goal of SAP policies was to put in place a set of mechanisms for achieving development by relying on the market with minimal state interference. A crucial aspect of these policies were the promise of policy changes by recipient countries in exchange for aid. Therefore, the government started to balance its budget books by expenditure cuts to some social services, for instance, in education services, agriculture subsidies, and etc. Privatizing state corporation to attract more funds and to create a liberal trade environment, as well as trade liberalization through deregulation policies. By the end of the 1980s, Tanzania economies signaled that neoliberal policies failed to deliver distinct improvements in governance and economic performance. For example, from 1980s to 1989, debt ratios increased at an inevitable extent. Real per capita income fell drastically due to inequality between the export and imported values. African countries blamed the SAP policies. as Panaxias discuss or a grand modernizing and colonial narrative reflecting and serving Eurocentric interests. So that was the brain. While on the other side, donors, particularly the IMF and Rwanda, highlighted the institutional weaknesses within African countries where the main reason for SAP's policies failure. This is according to regular report in 1999. Therefore, from the 1990s, World Bank and other donors started to emphasize the reforms based on fundamental questions relating to human capacities, institutions, governance, the environment, population growth, and population growth and institutions, and technologies. On the other side, donors, particularly IMF, highlighted that institutional weakness within African countries were the reason for SAP failures, as I said, according to that report. The underlying factors behind the failure of African economies is a crisis of governance, poor governance. That's from this time, as I said, which was a period where the governance reforms started. Now let us see the period three. Now, after failure of market economy and structural adjustment program, now the shift started to be emphasized by donors to reform the Tanzanian economy in other African countries, from market-led economy reforms to governance reforms. That was 1990s debate. From 1990s, Tanzania government embarked on huge public sector reforms as a means to improve governance institutions that will cope with new governance environment. The reforms were interpreted as a way of improving capacity of governance institutions to make policy and service delivery in an efficient, effective, and accountable manner. It was advocated that policies, however good, will only work if those necessary institutions and institutional capacity to manage the virus. Therefore, it was concluded that good governance was essential for development. If these countries want to develop the institutional capacities are very important. Therefore, following this trend, Tanzania government from 1990s started to implement series of reforms as follows. It includes the public service reforms, the 1 and 2. Second is public finance management reform. Also, the local government reform program. Also, the legal sector reform program. Strengthening the prevention and combating of corruption in Europe with its supervising, which supervises and guiding the operation of prevention and corruption of Corruption Act number 11 of 2007. Establishment of the Presidential Commission of Inquiry Against Corruption. The establishment of Commissions for Human Rights and Good Governance, which supervises and guides the operation of Act number 7 of 2001. And Act number 12 of 2003 in Tanzania, mainland, and Zanzibar, respectively. Establishment of Code of Ethics and Conducts for Public Service of 2005 is another institution which was committed to be reformed. So, those were the institutional reforms which were targeted in order to improve the governance structure at that era, from 1990s to date. After having such a trend of historical development of public administration in Tanzania, now let us shift our attention into another aspect, which is the Tanzania government structure. Now let us see the Tanzania government structure, how it is. The United Republic of Tanzania is a unitary state with national government in both Tanzania mainland and in Zanzibar. Tanzania Zanzibar have the authorities over all non-union matters. The national governments, both in Tanzania mainland and Zanzibar, are divided into central government and local government. So we shall see the structure of both the central and the local government. So beginning with the central government, say that this is the central organ vested with authority over who matters within the Tanzania boundaries. Within central government, say that this central government has divided into three organs. There are three organs, I'd say, for central government of the United Republic of Tanzania. One is an executive, second is the judiciary, and the third is the legislature. So let us look into details of all these organs of the state. Beginning, it is the executive. The executive of the United Republic of Tanzania comprises of the president, the vice president, president of Zanzibar, the prime minister, cabinet and ministers. These are the constituents of the executive group, the branch of the central government. The president of the United Republic of Tanzania is the head of state, the head of government, and the commander-in-chief of the army forces. Only the president is the leader of the executive of the United Republic of Tanzania. So that is one of the components of the executive. Another is the vice president, who is the principal assistant to the president in all matters of the United Republic of Tanzania. The vice president is responsible for following up the daily implementation of human matters, performing all duties assigned to him by the president, performing all duties and functions of the president's office when the president is out of the country. The prime minister is another constituent of an executive. The prime minister of the United Republic of Tanzania is the leader of government business in the National Assembly. She controls and supervises and executes daily functions and affairs of the government of the United Republic. And if any other matters, the president directs to be done. Another one, which is President of Zanzibar. There is a President of Zanzibar. This is the head of executive for Zanzibar. That is the revolutionary government of Zanzibar. And he is the chairman of the Zanzibar Revolutionary Council. Another one, which is the cabinet of ministers. The cabinet of ministers includes the prime minister, who is appointed by the president from among members of the National Assembly. The government executes its function through ministers, led by cabinet ministers. Therefore, we have prime ministers and the ministers in by whom. Now let us see another organ of the state, the central government, which is the legislature. The legislature, or the parliament, by another name, of the United Republic of Tanzania consists of two parts, that is the president and the National Assembly. The president exercises authority vested in him by the constitution to assent to bills by parliament in order to complete the enactment process before they become law. The National Assembly, which is another part, which is the principal legislative organ of the United Republic, has authority on behalf of the people to oversee and be accountable to the government of the United Republic and all its organs on their particular duties. So this is an organ representing the interests of the people, or overseeing the interests of people being complied by the executive. Also, the parliament is headed by a speaker, who is assisted by a deputy speaker, and the clerk as the head of the secretariat of the National Assembly. Also, the National Assembly also has various standing committees to support its various functions. The National Assembly of Tanzania is constituted by one chamber, with members selected from various constituencies across mainland Tanzania and Zanzibar. Under the constitution, women's representation is provided to a special category in order to increase the participation of women in the national politics. Another order of the central government is judiciary. The judicial system, let us see now the judicial system of mainland Tanzania, say that the legal system of Tanzania is largely based on common law. But also, it accommodates Islamic or customary law, customary laws, the later sources of law being kept upon personal or family matters. The judiciary is formed by various courts of judicature and is independent of the government. The constitution makes provision for the establishment of an independent judiciary and the respect of the principles of rule of law, human rights, and good governance. The judiciary of Tanzania has four types, and this is the structure of judiciary. The court of that is the court of appeal of the United Republic of Tanzania, the High Court for mainland Tanzania, in Tanzania Zanzibar, the magistrate courts, which are of two levels, that is the resident magistrate courts and the district court, both of which have concurrent jurisdictions. And below it, there are supreme courts. These are the lowest in the judicial hierarchy. Now, this is the whole structure of court system in Tanzania, as I've explained in the previous explanations, which is Court of Appeal again, the specialized divisions, and the High Court, and there is High Court of Tanzania, the High Court of Zanzibar. The resident magistrate courts are there, and below it, the district courts, and below outside, which is the primary. Primary courts. The details of this are as follows. The Court of Appeal. The Court of Appeal of Tanzania established under Article 108 of the Constitution. It is the highest court of the hierarchy of the judiciary in Tanzania. It consists of the Chief Justice and other Justices of Appeal. The Court of Appeal of Tanzania, it is the court of final appeal at the apex of the judiciary in Tanzania. Below it is High Courts. The High Courts of Tanzania was established under the Article 107 of the Constitution, and it has unlimited original jurisdiction to entertain all types of cases. The High Courts exercises original jurisdiction of matters on matters of constitutional nature and have powers to entertain election petitions. Below it, there is subordinate courts. This includes the resident magistrate courts and the district courts, which both enjoy concurrent jurisdiction. These courts are established under the Magistrate Courts Act of 1984. The district courts, unlike the resident magistrate courts, are found throughout all the districts in Tanzania. That is the local government unit. They receive appeals from the primary courts, several of which will be found in one district. The legislative magistrate courts are located in major towns, municipalities, and cities, which serve as the regional provisional headquarters. At the lowest level, we have the primary courts. The primary courts are the lowest courts in the hierarchy. They are established under the Magistrate Courts Act of 1984. They deal with criminal cases and civil cases. Civil cases on property and family law and matters which apply customary law and Islamic law has to be initiated at the level of primary courts, where the magistrate sits with lay assessors, that is the jury system, that not apply Now we have another segment, which is tribunals. There are specialized judicial institutions. These are specialized judicial institutions, which form part of the judicial structure. These, for example, include the district land, the housing tribunal, the tax tribunal, you have the tax appeals tribunal, labor reconciliation board, the Tanzania Industrial Court, and the military tribunals for the armed forces. The military courts do not try civilians, which is the aspect to note. For importance, let us see the judicial system in the revolutionary government of Zanzibar. We say that Zanzibar court system is quite similar to Tanzania mainland system, except that Zanzibar retains Islamic courts. These adjudicate Muslim family cases such as divorces, child custody, and inheritance matters. All other appeals from the High Court of Zanzibar go to the Court of Appeals of Tanzania. Below it is the structure of the judicial system of the revolutionary government of Zanzibar. Now, as you can see here in Abadan, we have the arrangement of court system in Zanzibar, which we are going to illustrate as follows. We have a court of appeal of Tanzania at the top. This court of appeal of Tanzania handles all matters from the High Court of Zanzibar. So the High Court of Zanzibar, as we have said, it throws its appeal to the Court of Appeal of Tanzania. Not we have High Court and High Court of Zanzibar. The High Court of Zanzibar is a structure in the same structure as the High Court of Tanzania mainland. It handles all appeals from the lower subordinate courts. Below it, we have the magistrate courts. These courts have jurisdiction to entertain cases of different nature, except for the cases under Islamic law, which they have no jurisdiction to trials which are tried in the parties' courts. Below, we have Kadhi's Appeal Court. This main role of the Kadhi's Appeal Court of Zanzibar is to hear all appeals from the Kadhi's Court, which adjudicates on Islamic law. The Kadhi's Courts, these are the lowest courts in Zanzibar, which adjudicate all Islamic family matters, such as divorce, distribution of matrimonial assets, custody of children, and inheritance, but only with Muslim families. And at the lowest level, we have the primary courts. These have the same grounds as Kadhi's courts, and they deal with criminal and civil cases of customary nature. As we have said, we have two branches, that is the central and local government. Now we are in the local government structure. Now let us see the local government structure in brief. The Article 145 and 146 of the Constitution of the United Republic of Tanzania establishes the local government of Tanzania, its structure and its functions. The local governments in Tanzania are divided into urban authorities and the district authorities. The urban authorities, in urban authorities, there are city councils, municipal councils, and town councils, where wards are divided into the town and have administrative committees, not the councils. This is according to the Act number 7 and the Act number 8 of urban authorities. Another, it is the district authorities. These are, say that the district authorities is divided into two levels, at the district level and at the village level. So this is, in short, it is a structure at the local government structure. Dear students, we are reaching at the end of our lecture. Thank you for watching. That is all for today. for further discussion on this knowledge area. For let us meet in Moodle platform. There we will have active and vibrant discussion on various aspects related to this knowledge area. So, thank you for watching. Thank you for your attention. And welcome again. Until then, bye-bye.